And what about the cattle kind? Well, they reproduce after their own kind. And these finches, you know, they haven't even changed into another type of bird. They have reproduced after their own kind. They are just varieties within the finch kind. You see, all this is consistent with scriptures. It's one of the things I hope that you've realized here. You know, I'm grateful for Taz Walker's talk, especially the one last night that he gave here, that he was showing that all this geology can be explained in terms of flood geology. We need to, you know, take back the geology. I absolutely love geology. I tried to do a PhD in geology and I couldn't because there wasn't any money available. But I just spend all my holidays looking for fossils. That is my, I'm one of these terrible people. If I'm not on holiday looking for fossils, I'm working. It's as simple as that. And I think that we need to realize that geology agrees with the scriptures. And certainly with regard to what we've just looked at, these plants and animals reproduce after its kind and after their kind. You see, Psalm 118 tells us, it is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. Well, what about the fossils? Don't they prove evolution? People often say this to me. Well, we can have a look at various fossils, like these two, Lingula and Lingulella. Lingula, there you can see. You can go to the Pacific Ocean and you find those shells still alive today. There has been no change whatsoever. We can see here a sea urchin and a modern sea urchin, and there has been very little change. You know, I went to university in the 1960s, and I was in a geology department where nobody cared if you were a creationist, because that word, as far as they were concerned, hadn't been invented then, and they didn't care. They attacked evolution. I had a paleontology lecturer, and he used to spend more time telling us why evolution could not possibly have occurred, in spite of the fact that it has occurred, than he did telling us about why it had occurred. And one of his arguments against evolution was, he said, have you noticed you go fossiling? He said, I've taken you students fossiling. You find a shell, you find some plants, you find some animals. You know what it is instinctively. He used to say to us there was three types of animals which have become extinct. Dinosaurs, trilobites and graptolites. And you know, since then, they found graptolites in the Pacific Ocean. So he says, so if he was talking to you now, he would say, and I'm saying to you, apart from trilobites and apart from dinosaurs, you recognize that sea urchin on the right-hand side as being, well, you know it's a sea urchin because it's a live, living one, but the fossilized one, you recognize it as a sea urchin. Why? Why is it that we recognize crinoids? On the slide there, you can see a fossilized crinoid, and whenever you find it fossilized, it's usually in limestone, and they're called crinoidal limestones, and the other one is one that's alive and well because they live off the coast of the UK. There's been no change whatsoever between the fossilized ones and the ones that we find living today. And you know, you don't need a PhD in paleontology to recognize these creatures. Frogs have not changed, and neither has the coelacanth. The coelacanth, the fossilized one at the top there, and the one on the bottom, which is the one that was found in 1938 and living in the Indian Ocean off the coast of South Africa, and we've now found groups of them living off the coast of Indonesia. There's been no change. When they found this one, they got very excited because they said it was a living fossil. They wouldn't accept that evolution hadn't occurred. Oh no. The fact that they hadn't found one, they reckoned, you know, in the fossil record for millions and millions of years. Forget it. So this question is, are fossils really evidence for evolution? And the answer to this question is no. It's a resounding no. You know, when I first met Dwayne Gish in the 1970s, he had written a book called Evolution, the Fossils Say No. And then he wrote another one, didn't he? Evolution, the Fossils Say No, expanded, revised edition. And now he's written one, Evolution, the Fossils Still Say No. I know Dwayne has just retired and he hopes to rewrite this. What will he call it? It'd be very interesting to think if you can think of a good title. You see, we need to get back to what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that God created everything in 6 literal days. And you know, it wasn't just in Genesis, it was in Exodus as well. I had a deacon of a church recently say to me, "You know, Dr. White, you taught me something this morning." I said, "What did I teach you?" He said, "You taught me that creation in six literal days is also in the book of Exodus." He said, "I'd never noticed that verse." He'd never noticed this slap bang in the middle of the Ten Commandments, where it says that in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth. He made it himself in six literal days. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. You know that when you tell people that, what is their reaction? I love, in some ways, teaching and going into schools, especially when you've got these stroppy 16, 17-year-old teenagers who think they know everything. You know, and usually by the time they're 22, they realize they don't know everything. And when you're my age, you know that you know very, very little. And they usually say to me, "Oh, where did God come from?" You know? And they seem to think that they're the first person that has ever thought of that question. They seem to think that that question demolishes the whole of the Bible, the whole of Christendom, and the whole of your arguments about creation. And you have to say to them, "Look, you know, we theologians, or the theologians, don't get together and make up God. What we do is read the Bible and we find out who God is from the Bible. The God of the Bible did not have a beginning and did not have an end, or will not have an end. He is the God that's always existed and he always will exist." And, you know, asking this question, "Where did God come from?" is like asking the stupid question, like, "What does the color red smell like?" It's an oxymoron. God did not have a beginning. That's who God is. By definition, that's who God is. If you think otherwise, you are not believing in the God of the Bible. Well, what about the evolutionists? What do they say? What do they teach? Well, what I want to do is to go back to the 1950s. Why? Because I was an atheist in the 1950s. And I used to argue with Christians about their God and about the Bible. And I used to point out that the scientists had discovered the continuous evolution of the universe, that there was no beginning to the universe, there would be no end to the universe, and that it was always the same. And, so, you know, most Christians all the Christians I spoke to did not have any arguments. I used to say to them, "How can you possibly believe in a book which starts off in the beginning when the evolutionists and the scientists have shown there was no beginning?" And they used to walk away from me. No wonder I was an atheist. I didn't meet people who got answers to the questions that I had until I got to university, and then I met somebody who got all the answers. Well, what about now? Well, they believe the Big Bang. You think about it for a moment. What does the Big Bang teach? It teaches, in the beginning, nothing exploded. You know the difference between creation and evolution? In the beginning, God created. In the beginning, nothing exploded. I find that evolutionists don't like me saying that. I had one evolutionist come to me at the end of a meeting, and he said, "How dare you say such a thing? How dare you mock what we believe?" And I said, "All right, what do you believe?" I said, "Do you believe in the beginning?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Do you believe there was nothing?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Do you believe that nothing exploded?" He said, "Yes." He said, "What's the problem?" And this nothing is supposed to give rise to the universe. With all the stars, with all these galaxies. With all these galaxies that we can see on this illustration here. And the question is, you know, how many stars are there in the universe? What I want to try to do is just to give you an idea. Because we're told that there are 100,000 million galaxies. And each of these galaxies contain 100,000 million stars. And if you multiply those two numbers together, you get that number. And the question is, how big is that number? Well, let me give you some idea. Imagine you can count 3 million every second. It takes about a second to say the word chimpanzee. So, chimpanzee, 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 chimpanzee. You know, you've counted 3 million every time I say that word. And you did that for over 100 million years. You would just about get there. And you know what the Bible says? The Bible says that God created all those stars. It's almost given as an afterthought, isn't it, by Moses? He said, "Oh, God created the stars also." Or he made the stars also in Genesis chapter 1, verse 16. All those. And, you know, we are, you know, God is our Heavenly Father. And we go to our Heavenly Father, who's the Creator, the one who created all these stars. So many of them, it would be impossible for any of us to count them. And yet the Bible tells us that He counts them and He calls them all by their name. And then we go to him and we say, we've got this little problem, Lord, and we'd like you to help us if you can possibly do that. Of course he can. He's a great God, isn't he? But we're told that everything came from nothing by the evolutionists. And you know, this nothing is so profound it defies human comprehension. This is a quote from a book about the Big Bang.